All right, welcome guys again. So this is the second part of the introduction to software testing that we started last week. So it's like I said, it's a training hosted by Blue Sky Citadel, which is a non-profit educational institution by RCCG City of God in Crayford, London. So we offer free IT training courses in different disciplines, introduction to IT, introduction to Excel, and also advanced Excel. So software testing with different flavors. We've done Java, we've done with C Sharp, we've done with Speculoo. Now also we do also place people on internship for different programs. So and today we're going to focus on introduction to software testing. So, and last week we've done a quick introduction. So today we're going to continue that. Okay, let's continue. Today we're going to discuss about different test process, and also we're going to discuss about test level, test types, and also we're going to also discuss about the test techniques if time permits. So first thing about that we're going to discuss today is the fundamental test process. So we have different test processes in development, actually, so in development life cycle. So the most common one that we're going to discuss today is going to be the waterfall module, the V module, agile, and there are different flavor of agile. As people already know, there's Scrum, there's Kanban, SP, and the likes, but today we're going to focus on Scrum, and we're going to look into that. So this is not Agile class, so bear with me, I might not touch on every part of Agile. This is basically introduction to software testing. So if you're interested in learning Agile, this is not the class for it. So but I will try as much as possible to go into this life cycle in not in great detail, but as required for a tester. So waterfall, what exactly is waterfall methodology? So waterfall module is very popular, and I think in when I started even development and also testing was one of the development life cycle that are so popular, and it's basically the traditional approach or the classic one. So it is your development life cycle is defined in linear or sequential order. So each level of your development life cycle has a distinct goal and for each of the
What's
phase
it?
of development. So you so for waterfall development, and like I said, it's got distinct goal for each of the phase of development. So for instance, the requirements, you need to know at the requirement stage, you need to test the requirements. At the system design, you need to have tested system. At integrate implementation stage, there's also goals to be achieved on that. So everything now moves that like that. So and it goes from then. So in but this is an analogy that I will use to define waterfall. It's basically like, as you know, water is falling on the cliff. So, and if you have water running down, flowing to the edge of the cliff, it cannot go back again. So that is the same thing with waterfall. So in waterfall, it's the same thing that development starts from requirement, it goes to system design, implementation, and also it goes to the integration and testing. So and if you want to go to the top, it becomes difficult and also costly. So what happens in this instance is that when user come, they want to build a system, they get a requirement, and there will be a technical author or technical design engineer that convert that requirement into a system design, and also the developer will implement that particular design, and then they give to a tester to test. So the tester tests and also give feedback. So, and after that, there will be deployment of the system, and the system now goes into a maintenance phase. But the problem that we have with this system is like, if as a tester, that most of us we are, and you are sitting at this particular level of integration and testing, so, and you find any bug, when you found that bug, if the bug is in the requirement, so that means the system has to go into the requirement phase and go down again and go into the system design and go into implementation and go into testing again. So by that, it's very, very costly. That's why I said, if you want to proceed into the previous phase, it is very, very costly. For instance, if you want to go from your system, from your integration testing, and you want to say, okay, the problem is on system design, and that means you have to do implementation of that system again, you have to even do retesting again, perhaps maybe the system already gone into maintenance and they now find issue in the maintenance, you have to go through all those things depending on where exactly the issue is. So that is the issue with waterfall. Like I said, if you want to remember this particular analogy, is basically knowing that it's like a cleft, basically. So when water is falling through from a mountain in a steep mountain, so it cannot return back to the top. So basically, it's the same thing. So the next one that we want to discuss, the next methodology, is V-module. V-module, as the name implies, is verification of and also validation module. So in this module, every testing execution should follow some sequence. And by sequence, I mean there is a perfect way for you to perform each of these steps. So, and there is a perfect ways to perform the test approaches that you're going to follow. So what you're going to do in a V module is like, at the user requirements, when users are gathering requirements, there will be preparation of a document, which is you will call assessment test document. They will prepare it at hand. And then the system, when it goes into system requirement also, you also prepare a system testing document also. Then also, even in the unit testing, also they will also do that, something like that. So then after implementation, so then it goes back again and you start to execute those documents as you go up in the ladder. So you do your integration testing, you do your unit testing, which is also component testing, you do your integration testing, and you do your system testing, you do your acceptance testing, and you do your operational testing, but based on the document that you have already provided before. So you're going to move down on the ladder when you are doing development, and you're going to move up in when you are doing your testing. Basically, it means that you are going to get your system requirements, you are going to get your user requirement rather, and you're going to get your system requirements, you're going to get your design done, and you're going to get your detailed design also done, and you're going to get your implementation or done. And then after that, you get your unit testing done, you get your integration done, and you get your system. So on and on like that, that's what you will do in a V module. So testing start at the beginning of the project, basically, as you can see, but it's not that you're going to be testing, you're going to be doing the preparation of the document. But after that, then your testing is going to, because there's nothing that's going to be handed over to you before the implementation. Before the implementation, there will be requirements that you can actually work upon, and you can from the requirements, you can actually do your test cases. You can do your any test designs that you want to do. So you got those luxury, but your testing is still going to happen face on from unit testing face up like that. So that's the V module approach. And then that leads us to the next one, which is kind of very, very favorable one that people now use more often right now, which is Agile. So Agile is an iterative approach to project management and also software development. So it helps the customer to develop application faster, so to say, and also with a fewer headaches. So, but instead of like what we've seen before, instead of the implementation of the whole system happening at the bottom part of the system when you gather your requirement and you just do everything. So it is not the case for Agile. In Agile, you do everything in iteration. You divide your application into different parts and requirement gathering for that particular part of the product, and then you do basically all this in chunk of the system. You don't do everything in a big bang like we've done in the previous one. So in V-module, if you are working on a let's say on a website, actually let's say product, on a big product, you gather every requirement for all that particular product, and you gather the system requirement, you do the design for everything, and then you go into implementation of the system. And then after that, so it's different from waterfall. The requirement is done, system is done, implementation is already done, then testing starts. So then when testing starts, then you need to start gathering, you need to now take the requirements, write your test cases and everything, and do everything from there, because that's where your testing starts. And even tester is not required at the beginning of the project, basically. So at the beginning of project requirements, they do requirement gathering, that might be months, and you do your system design, that might be another month. So, and you do your implementation also. But after that, you start your testing. But then V-module is a bit better than waterfall in the sense that even at the beginning of the project, testing can be involved. So, but what you are going to be doing at that particular time is, as the requirement has been generated, you are going to be writing your acceptance testing document. You are going to add also when they move to system requirements, you're going to be generating your system test documents or your test plan. In some cases, you might not be in a project that test plan now runs into maybe 100 or 1,000 page document or something like that, because some people will sit down in there for like 7 months. What they are going to be doing is, we are writing test script. And they can be there for many months writing only test script for a particular project, and because even the implementation is not yet done, and then when implementation is done, what happens is like the system must have even changed. The test script is no longer valid. Everything is now changed. So that is the disadvantage of V-module. But in Agile, so you only take a part of that system. And you take a part of the system, you do a requirement for that particular system, and then also you test that particular part of the system, and you hand that over to the business to be able to test. So in that, you get a feedback quickly, and then also development team also work together. There's a collaboration and also communication, even that is an angst in that particular team, because in the previous one that we have in V-module, so even sometimes you don't need to talk to the developer because they don't hand over anything to you. you might just sit down there and start writing requirements. Developers also, because they are doing implementation, they bury their head on the computer and then they are coding away, not talking to tester. Then you don't get feedback on time about what they are developing. So when they finish development, then you bring those documents that you've created based on this different level of the cycle. For instance, if you are now going to be doing your system testing, you bring out your system testing test script. If you are going to be doing your acceptance testing, you bring your acceptance testing document, which is based on the user requirement. So, but in Agile, it's a different totally. You have less documentation, so to say. So because of that, you tend to collaborate more with developers, and also you tend to see changes more quickly from there. So as you can see from here, from this diagram that you can see, the first thing you said in a cycle, you come in, you find, oh, there's a requirement coming in. You do the design, or the BA does the design, and it's developed, and they test quickly. So that cycle of sprint one goes into that for each of the products, or even an item that is in the sprint. So then also, after everything in the sprint has finished, that is released to the user, and you move to another sprint, and on like that, you go into that cycle, so that before that finish. So as I said also, there are different flavor of Agile, and to be honest, it's so Agile that there are other flavor. It makes it to be even more like fragile, to be honest. So, and you need to be sure which type of Agile that you are following at work. So, as you know, we have Scrum, we have Kanban, and some people, there's even Kanban or. So it's like, it's not Kanban now, it's not Scrum, so it's now mixed together. So, but as I know, Agile Scrum is one of the most popular framework for implementing Agile, to be honest. So popular that even many people, when you are mentioning Scrum, they think Scrum is Agile, but it's not. It's totally not. It's not Agile. So there are other parts that I've mentioned. There's Kanban also. I think also there's also SP, another flavor for Agile. But one thing I so enjoy, and I know that about Scrum, is the commitment to work projects, commitment to short iteration, commitment to deliverables. That in Scrum, you are committed to a particular task or some tasks that you are going to do within that sprint. So, and I mentioned sprint. Sprint is a short or time box period when a scrum team should deliver a set of work. So what does that mean actually? So when you work in an Agile and you are using Scrum, you will have a time allocated in each of the sprints. That your sprint could be 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, or 5 weeks. But they're different, like I said, they're different flavor, but the most common one that you will hear about are 2 week sprints, short and then committed work, so that within 2 weeks you are able to deliver something. You are able, then what you are going to be committing to the sprint is something that you can be able to deliver within 2 weeks. So those things that you will think that okay,
good.
Commit to. So for instance, if you are working on a website, and let's say you're working on a website, and this website you have registration to do, you have excuse me,
please.
So for instance, in this project, you may have registration to be done, you may have login to be done, you may have maybe posting the blogs to be done, you may have other features like feedbacks to be done, you may have user account to be done. You might also have maybe different features that you want to do, and this thing can take maybe few months for them to done. Let's say 6 months. For in waterfall, everything has to be spec'd out. Everything has to be spec'd out. Everything has to be developed. Then they give it to a tester to start testing, maybe a few months after it's been developed. But in Agile, it's not that so. What you're going to do is, maybe in 2 weeks, you're going to say, we're going to do only the registration and login, and that's it. So within 2 weeks, you'll be able to show to the user that the user can register and the user can login, and that's it. And you commit to that. And then what that means is that within 1 or 2 days, you are able, as a tester, to get something from developers. So it's not like you are going to be sitting for a few months before you can actually get something. Within a few days or 1 or 2 days, you're going to be getting something from developers. So in a Scrum team, who are the people that make a Scrum team? So the first, there are three sets of people that you have in a Scrum team. One of them is a Scrum Master, and you have the Product Owner, and you have the Dev Team, which people call developers. So a Scrum Master is meant to organize the Scrum. I meant organize, not manage. So because a Scrum team is self-management. No, there is no concept of a manager in a Scrum team. Also, it's self-management, it's self-reliance. Everyone should know what they need to do at a very particular time. You go to the board, you take your tax, and then you hand over. So, but the Scrum team is there to facilitate the Scrum and to make sure things are run in order, and to also train people to make sure that they follow the concept and the principle of Agile. And also, for Scrum Master also is there to remove any impediment, to remove any blocker that the team will have. Basically, it's going to be there to ensure that the team does what they're meant to do best, basically. And also to go for meetings, to give report to the business owners and also the stakeholder about how the team is doing. Another person also within the Scrum team is the Product Owner. Basically, this is the person that actually tells the team, this is the next project that you need to do. This is the next type that you need to do. From his own priority, he goes in there and he prioritizes the backlog. So I mentioned about backlog. Backlog is now different tasks that you need to do. So these are different tasks that you need to do. So you have two types of backlog. One backlog is the product backlog, which is everything that you need to do in for that particular product. So, and also you can also have, you will also have a sprint backlog. From the product backlog, you bring other things into the sprint. So for instance, in your product backlog, you can have maybe 500 items to be developed. So like I mentioned, you can have the login, you can have the registration, you can have the feedback, you can have the posting, you can have the blogs, you can have different functionalities that you want to do. But then at the beginning of the sprint, you look into there, and you can say, oh, we want to do 5 items in this particular sprint. You bring that particular 5 items into the sprint backlog. And it's the responsibility of the product owner to actually prioritize those things. That say, okay, this is what we want to do next. This is what should be done next, because it's the product owner of that of the application. Then both of them also, there's also business owner and also stakeholders, those ones that pay for or that finance the project. And so, 1 minute, I think there's a question. So I think that is that. So, and like I said, we have three types of people in the Scrum team. So the Scrum Master, the Product Owner, and also we have the development team. Now you will ask question and say, where is the tester? Where is the developers? Where is the business analyst? So yeah, so those has been categorized as dev team, and some people will just call everyone a developer. So, but you as a QA, as a developer, or as a business analyst, there are other roles also that are needed to be able to build that application. Everyone is categorized as a part of, as a member of the dev team. So, okay, so that is that for the Agile and also the test methodologies that we've done. Also, I've mentioned about it. So one thing I also want to talk about is now the ceremonies in Agile. So I think I left that slide out. The ceremonies, as in, what do you do as a QA in Agile? So what's your role in Agile? I'll just go through day-to-day activities of, let's say, an automation tester in an Agile team. So the first thing you do in the beginning of the sprint, you might do one of the ceremonies that's called sprint planning or backlog refinement. So where you go in there, and you, like I said, you have your product backlog, which contains everything about the application that you want to build. So, and you need to review those product backlog items and then to prioritize them and say, these items need to be brought into the sprint. So from there, you now do something, another ceremony that is called grooming session. So the people call it different names anyway. So at the grooming session, you now sit down and now deliberate on those items in your product backlog items to see, oh, these particular items, you want to be able to bring them into the sprint, but we don't know the effort that we need to be able to do them. So what you need to do, read the requirements, and then bring your input as a QA, and also developer also will bring their input as a developer, and also even everyone. So from there, you will now estimate that particular item. So there are different ways to estimate an item, so, or work item. So some people use t-shirt sizes to say small, medium, large, or extra large. Some people use point system. So I think I favor the point system, to be honest. So because then you can use Fibonacci series. Fibonacci series is 1, 2, 3, 5, 8. It's actually in the same way. 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 plus 1 is 3, 3 plus 2 is 5, 5 plus 3 is 8. Then 8 plus 3 is 13, 13 plus 8 is 21. On and on like that. That's how you get the Fibonacci series. So in the grooming session, you can estimate and you can say, oh, you as a QA will look at the story and you can say this story is 2 points, and developer can look at it and say this story is 5 points. Another person can look at it and say this story is maybe 8 points. So you deliberate on the point system. But another thing also that I found is when you are doing that, so you see some people that are vocal, some people that got more experience will always take the day. Because, for instance, if you meet someone in a work, actually, the person has been there for like 8 years, and you are just there for 1 or 2 days, and the person said this item is going to take 5 points, and I bet you will just align and say, yeah, 5 points, because you don't know the application that well. You think you don't know the application that well. But if John, that has been there for 8 years, can say 5 points, you want to do that. You want to say, oh, it's 5 points. John said that. So because of that, some people favor the approach of using a poker series. So in that regard, it's like, so that people don't some voices are not so okay. 1 minute. Okay, like I said, so in the process of doing the grooming, so and you see some people literally cheating, saying, okay, when John has said five, James will also say five. Because John is experienced, then Mark also will say five. Then everyone will just say five because John has said so. So to solve that issue, people, some teams are now using poker series. So what they do is that you bring like a poker, like a card, basically. So everyone will get that card. It's got like 1, 3, and it's got the Fibonacci series. Everyone got a pack of that card. So when the after deliberation of that particular story, they will now ask everyone to bring their card out. So you bring it at the same time. So or some people that are so traditional will now say, you don't need to shout it out. You want to say 1, 2, 3, then raise your hand to say if you want or two. So we want to do it simultaneously so that no one is actually looking sideways to just to spy on what other people are saying. Because what happens is like you want everyone to have a say in a scrum. You want everyone to have a say. Because it's possible that John may be experienced because he knows the code so well. But James is just joining, right? And doesn't know. So he also needs time to be able to do that thing that John is doing. So because even John could say five, it might also mean 8 or even 13 for James. So that voice needs to be heard also. It's also possible that even as a Kiwi, sometimes you might feel like your voice is being suppressed because developer is saying it is 3 and you want to say, oh yeah, it's easy to develop, but there are a lot of things that I need to test. So because of that, you need to go to be able to present that in using that poker series. So that's what used to solve the issue. So yeah, so that is that on in time of the ceremony. So then after that, what you are going to do in a scrum, you're going to do another meeting that when you start as a Kiwi, let's say you are automation tester, right? So and even if you're a manual tester, so on your first day of the sprint, you've done the grooming, everything is in the sprint, then you need to do like a stand-up. At the stand-up, you are meant to answer 3 questions. 1, what did you do yesterday? What are you going to do today? And is there any impediment or blocker that will prevent you from doing your job? So those are the 3 questions that you need to answer. 1, what you did yesterday, what you are going to do today, and is there any impediment that will prevent you from doing what you need to do? Those are the things that you want to answer. So then after that, you would expect to start sitting down, because on the first day of the sprint, you may not get anything from developers to test. Because you don't have anything to test, what are you going to be doing? You are not going to be folding your hands, because the requirements that will have written or about to be written. So you might have to do like what is called like a 3 amigo sessions. So when developer are picking up a story, you will do a 3 amigo session. You sit down with the developer and you sit down with the BA to write the requirement out, so that you can provide your own input into the requirement. So, and also, after that, you start writing your test cases out. So, as you can see now, you have a full knowledge of the application, because you start together with the business owner or product owner or the BA, and you analyze the requirement together. So, based on that, you can use that knowledge to start writing your test cases. If you are also automation tester, also you can start to write your given when then in Gherkin and put everything together. And you know, you cannot write your step definition because the application is not yet developed, but you can write your feature files, you can write your also you can write your page object to a point, even though you know maybe the other objects are not available. You can write your skeleton of your step definition also, and to that point. So, and also you can also run your application just to use like a test-driven development. So when you run it, you are sure that it's going to fail because there are other parts of the system that has not been developed. So, and that is you testing your application that it can actually fail, basically. Then from there, you move to another item that also needs to be designed. You design your test cases for them. Also, as a manual tester, you also design your feature file. If you are going to be doing automation, you do the same thing also. So you carry on like that until you get your first item that you need to be tested. Then when you get it also as a manual tester, you start to test that application. So when you start test application as a manual tester, so you go to your test case that you've written. So we're going to look into how to write your test cases in this test in this training. So I will tell you the test design approach and techniques that you can use, but I'm just going through this process so that you know what is your day-to-day as a agile tester. So after that, when you are testing your application, maybe there are bugs also. You raise your bug, and in your bug, what you put in your bug, you put your steps that you want to use to recreate, and we'll also go through that. And also on Tuesday next week, we're going to have another tutor that is going to actually go through with us a practical aspect of what I'm telling you right now. To go through how do you raise a bug, how do you design your test cases using a practical aspect of it. So we're going to be using Azure DevOps, which is formally called VSTS, or if you are ancient or traditional like myself, it was even the former test manager that it was there. So it has changed name from different parts, from test manager, VSTS, so it's now called Azure DevOps. So you're going to be using that. So, and okay, going back to our testing. So then when you test your application, there's a bug, you raise a bug, you put your step that you used to create it, and you put if there's any screenshot, you put that also. If there's any log, also you put it also. You might also put some priorities. Some people allow that also, or severity also, to see if it's critical. We go through how to analyze severity later in future. So to see how can I actually say this particular item is high or medium or critical. But all this goes into your test strategy, to be honest. So I'll also briefly mention test strategy maybe. That's another document that when you join a company as a tester, you need to ask for their test strategy. Every establishment should be able to have one. It defines what testing or quality should be in that particular organization. So if time permits, next week I will look into test strategy. Is a document that every team should have. So if your team don't have it, so maybe it's time for you to start preparing that. So, all right. So then you raise the bug. The developer fix the bug. After they fix the bug, and then you need to do retesting of that particular bug. I will go into another part of the session right now, which is talk about even the confirmation, different type of different levels of testing. So I think in terms of the methodology, so this is it. So that is that part of